decides to go on vacation. For 1 week, we miss him 1 week, so we give him the beats, and we're like, we got that with my last week. So he did a great job as delivering the message. But then when Brent decides to go on 2 week vacation, you get the bench warmer for the second week. So I apologize now. You get what you get. As Chris Wilson would say, don't break that. So I'll do my best not to keep us too long from the food. My dog will start smelling it now. So but we'll get through it. This last week, I nothing has come to mind as far as what to bring, what message to bring. Whatever throws on my heart. But since we've been dealing with the book of James Sunday morning in class, I just couldn't get it off my heart. So the previous week, we had a really great topic out of the beginning, two-thirds of chapter 4, and so that's just where my mind has been all week, and so I thought. And I apologize to everyone this morning and said, sorry, you're going to hear it again. But those that aren't or weren't in class, this will be the first time, so it'll be new to you. So this morning's scripture will come from James chapter 4. We're going to be looking at verses 1 through 12. So if you want to follow along with your Bible, that'd be great. We're going to kind of piecemeal it out a little bit as far as 1 to 3 verses up here at a time. Definitely it's good to grab another Bible. Verses up here will be coming out of the Holman. It's good to see what the NIV is saying or any other version, because we're going to look at several other words within the scripture. But what the message that we're going to settle on is this idea of conflict. Where does conflict come from? And how do we resolve it? What is the solution to conflict? James, the book of James has so many applications for all of us, and so many ways we can take these 12 scriptures and apply them in our lives, and the meaning that we give to them. This is the one that truly gets you. Here in this portion of James, he comes off of chapter 3, very, very loving, very calm. His message is seems a little bit different than what we read before chapter 4. But then when he gets into 4, James, the words that he uses, the direction that he goes, he gets stern a little bit. He gets direct. You could even say that it's similar to a parent with children. You come into the room and your two kids are fighting, and you get after it. Hey, knock that off. Go to your room. Pick up your toys. Take a shower. Go to bed. Right? Very stern, very direct, with commands saying, this is what you need to do. It could also be dealing with, you have a boss, and deadlines are coming up. And hey, we need to get this report out. We need to do this. Get this person on the line. We need to get this turned in. Same way that James is talking to the believers with this portion. And it's a way that we need to get our mindset in as we read these verses. James is not just telling us. He's teaching us. And we need to heed the warnings that he has. We need to understand what he's trying to get us to understand so that we can apply it in our lives and become better Christians. And so, this portion, James is going to tell us how we can obtain peace rather than this conflict in life. First, he's going to identify the source of conflict. Then we'll move on into the solution of conflict. Like I said, James is a great application book. But we've got to read it and understand it and apply it in our lives. That's what we need to do for this lesson. So, this passage first starts off with a question. James is asking us a question. What is the source of wars and fights among you? What is, he's asking, the conflict, the source of the conflict that you have? And so So if you mentioned, if James was asking this to you right now, what would you say your source of conflict in your life would come here? I'm sure we all have conflict, but what is your source? Think about the last time that you had a conflict, whether it was with someone or whether it was with a situation. What caused that conflict? I want you to hold on to that answer, because James doesn't let you answer that. Rather, he tells us what the answer is. In the next sentence, don't they come from the cravings that are at war within you? So James is saying that the very first source of conflict that you and I have and see are because of craving, because of passion, the strong desires and cravings that we have, the cravings we have for anything that we desperately want. And this war wages where? Where does James say that this war wages? Within us. It's an internal battle. So then going back to the question, when you thought about what your source of conflict, where it came from, how would you then identify yourself with it? Much easier to say, well, it's this person. It's my neighbor who parks on the grass. That's the source of my conflict. It's my boss that is the source of my conflict. Depending on the day, it may be your children that are the source of your conflict. But, dare I say, it may even be your spouse that is the source of your conflict. It's easy to jump to those conclusions and to think that it is someone else or something else that is the source of what causes strife or conflict or warring within you. But James tells us it's not. It is within us that is causing this conflict, the internal battle. So James doesn't say it's someone else. When we start looking at the source, we have to take the microscope, look through the microscope, and turn it internally. Look at our life. Look at what's going on inside of us, our thoughts, and our emotions, our will, and our heart. Because the enemy is within. The enemy is not that person. Not the person. It's not the kid. It's not the boss. It's us. It becomes a battle of self. A battle of self that has three different flavors to it, and we'll see what those different flavors are in the next verse. As it continues, it says, you desire and do not have. You murder and covet, you cannot obtain. You fight and war. This is the battle of self-centeredness. These strong desires for something more or better. These are the passions that James mentions in verse 1. We all have them. Those earthly desires for something better. Something that will give us pleasure or satisfaction. Something other than God that we think will bring about peace to us. We all do this. We all have this self-centeredness within us that just craves something. And when that thing boils up, it causes conflict in our life. And James points this out as one of the ways that this battle of self-centeredness surfaces and causes conflict. There is another way. It's not only self-centered, but is the idea of self-sufficiency. You do not have because you do not ask. So many have bought into the lie that if you ask for help, that it is a sign of weakness. And this is a lie. And this is a proud lie. This idea of not asking is simply the self-sufficient attitude of I can handle this. I'm the captain of my own ship. I'm the master of my sea. I can do this. I'm in I don't need you. And worst of all, we can fall into the idea of, I don't need God. So it is a battle of self-sufficiency. I don't need anyone else. I don't need my brothers and sisters. I don't need God. I'm the battle. And when you wage this war, we have confidence. And then there is a third way that this battle of self works. This battle of self works its way out. And it's the idea of self-consumption. Verse 3, you ask and do not receive because you ask with the wrong motive, that you may spend it on your evil desires. Those evil desires being those same cravings and passions in verse 1, the passions that war within us, are the one same passions that we're trying to achieve. But we are trying to achieve them with wrong motives. They're not lining up with God's will for us. This idea of the battle for self, whether it is self-centeredness, self-efficiency, or whether it is this urge to spend it on our own passions, to consume whatever resource we have on me, is the battle that rages and emerges within each and every one of us that is here this morning. It's a big battle. The monster of self is hungry. And this monster demands to be fed all the time. And this is why James has become so passionate about providing this warning about where this source of conflict is found. It's found right here. Learn how to battle against it, this idea of self. And then James moves from this idea of self into a second major cause of conflict. And this second major cause is found in verse 4. So it says, adulteresses, don't you know that friendship with the world is hostility towards God? So whoever wants to be the world's friend becomes God's enemy. So this second source is unfaithfulness. James makes a point here to abuse us. There's an accusation. He's calling us adulterers or adulterers. You adulterers, you who are unfaithful. Now, is he necessarily talking about this adulteral relationship within marriages? No. He has a bigger picture. Talking about the idea of spiritual adultery, being unfaithful to our God, but the results of that are much similar to the results of adultery within marriage. It starts off with a strong desire for something more, something different. Soon there's a growing sense of unthankfulness for what you have, the relationship that God has given you. And then you're looking to someone else to satisfy. This unfaithfulness, whether to a spouse or to God, is not something you want to mess with. Adulteresses. Don't you know that friendship with the world is hostility toward God? Enmity with God is simply division from God. If we flirt around with this world, it will cause division between us. And that's nothing that we want. We don't want to be divided from God. But yet when we have unfaithfulness towards God, we are desiring things not from Him but of this world. And in doing so, we are being divided. We're being pulled away from Him. And even more, the scripture continues, so whoever wants to be the world's friend becomes God's enemy. So now, not only are we divided from God, but now we are at odds against God. We are set completely up. We are opposing God when we befriend this world. We become enemies. I don't know about you, but when you look at it in that light, and you are now on God's enemy list, that's a list I don't want to do. Because we all know at the end who wins. I don't In the next verse, we can see the third source of conflict. Or do you think it's without reason? The scripture says that the Spirit who lives in us yearns jealousy, that he gives greater grace. Therefore, he says, God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. The third source of conflict is having pride, being powerful, having a proud heart. It is the opposition that pride brings between us and God. God is a jealous God, and he does not want anything that step in between himself and his creation. And so he jealously longs for us to be in a relationship with him, but pride steps in and stops us from coming closer to him. It causes us to say, but I know better. I know better than him. Or I know better than her. And even worse, I know better than God. God stands against the proud attitude. So James has given us these three things that cause conflict: self, unfaithfulness, and pride. Pride is something described as the father of all sin. It is the root of so many sins in our life. It caused Satan and a third of the angels from heaven to fall. It caused Adam and Eve to fall, thinking that they know better than God. So James has identified the source, but he doesn't stop there. But he tells us the solution to the conflict. Going back to verse 6, but he gives us greater grace. Some versions may say more grace, which is kind of redundant, because God's grace is sufficient. God's grace is abundant. God's grace is everywhere. So when we say greater grace or more grace, there's a redundancy in it, but it's to bring the point home that God's grace is enough for us. God's grace is the answer to the selfishness, to the lustfulness, to the pride that we have, the unfaithfulness that we have. It is sufficient for all of our sins. It is more than what we need, more than enough. And who does God give his grace to? It tells us here as well. He gives his grace to the humble. The opposite of being pride is humility. The humble will bend their knees to God. The humble will say, no, God, you know better. And I will bend my will to yours and learn from you. The humble will not stand against God, but allow him to lead. So we have grace and humility as the solution to the conflict in our life. But he also doesn't stop there. He moves into a set of commands for us as well, as we continue to the first. A set of commands that will help guide us, give us something attainable, something, some actions that we can actually do that keeps us away from falling into this conflict. And it kind of gives them in a rapid fire sense, starting in 7 and going on. Where it says, therefore, submit to God, but resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, sinners, and purify your hearts, double-minded people. Be miserable and mourn and weep. Your laughter must change to mourning and your joy to sorrow. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will exalt you. Don't criticize one another, brothers. He who criticizes a brother or judges his brother criticizes the law and judges the law. Judge the law, and you are not a doer of the law, but a judge. There is one lawgiver and judge who is able to save and destroy, but who are you to judge your neighbor? So there are 6 commands given here within this human version. 9 of them are centered around our relationship with God, and the last will point us to how we relate to each other verbally. And they're all kind of wrapped around three main words: position, purity, and penitence. Now, if we go through here, we can see which one relates to each of those three. With the position, let's look at verses 7 and 8. Therefore, submit to God. Submit here is a word that means lining up with someone who has authority over you, following underneath that authority and not straying off of it. Because you realize that their authority is as your best interest at heart. So it's a position thing. We are lining up under God. When we submit to Him, we are saying, you have rule in my life. You are who I need to follow. So we get in line. We change our position. And what's funny is when we do that, Scripture also says to resist the devil. That's a position to be in. When we fall under God, we are pulling ourselves away from the devil's scheme. We're pulling ourselves away from his chain that he is tied to him, and saying no or yes to God. What's funny is, when we do that, the Scripture tells us that we will do it. In other portions of the Scripture, we always see this image of the devil as a lion, a roaring lion, looking to devour those people. I don't know about you, but I see the one thing. I'm going to be the one running. But here, James tells us that when we submit to God, when we resist the devil, it is Satan who then runs from us. And that's powerful. That's knowing that although Satan is powerful, and he can deceive us, if he can trick us, and if he can make us stumble, by lining up with God, by changing our position, he will run from us. And that brings a lot of peace to my mind. Realizing that I've got someone in my life who is more powerful than Satan. It continues by saying, draw near to God. Again, another position change. We have to draw near. When we submit, we cannot stay apart. I can say, yep, God, I'm going to submit to you, but you stay over there. I'm going to stay over here in my little sandbox and play over here. But that's not what James is telling us. He says, draw near to God. Get close to it. How do we get close to it? His word. We need to be reading His word and knowing what it means to draw close to the God who loves us, that He gave His Son for us. And if we do that, God also has a position. If we draw near to Him, God will draw near to us. Continuing on, it says, cleanse your hands, sinner, and purify your heart. That's what my people. And so here we have a purity issue. We have a position change, but then we also have a purity issue. We need to cleanse our hands. Why? Because we're sinners. We need Christ's cleansing blood in our lives in order to do that. We need to purify our hearts. We need to change the conflict inside of us. We need to change our motives. We need to change how we see things in order to have this purity in our hearts. Another stat that kind of gives us to it is James is calling us, not only is he calling us adulterers, now he's calling us double-minded people. How easy is it to be a good Sunday Christian when we come to here? Fellowship of communion, hear a lesson, but then Monday morning, we get out of bed and we become someone who change our heart, we change our mind, we draw away from God, and then we are serving ourselves again. We have a sense of pride in what we've accomplished with God. We have a sense of selfishness. Selfish about what we have or what we don't have. And then we become adulterers. done. We then are looking to someone else or something else to give us that food, or to give us that satisfaction, or to lean upon the Lord of strength. And so, rightfully so, James is calling us double-minded because we draw close and then we draw and we push him away. He's our Lord and our Savior, but I don't want to change. James continues and he says, be miserable, mourn, and your laughter must change to mourning and joy to sorrow. James is talking about having a repentant heart to that position. When we are living in sin, when we are doing wrong things, when we are sinning against God, we need to be mourning. We need to have sorrow. We need to be having the Holy Spirit tug at our heartstrings and feel convicted about what we're doing and that it's wrong. Because if we're not feeling these things, if we're not mournful, sorrowful, and we're still feeling good about what we're doing, that's a scary position. Is the Holy Spirit really knowing what we're doing? So we need to have a change to repentance. We need to realize what we're doing wrong. Verse 10 says, humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will exalt you. This one goes back to a position. When we humble ourselves, we are changing our position. No longer are we up here in our eyes, but now we become them. I would even say that we would be good sometimes. I don't feel it, but we probably would be good. We physically would be good. Get prosperous. Get down on the ground, on your knees, and humble yourself. Ask God to forgive you. Realize that it's not you. Like we talked about, humility, being humble is the complete opposite of pride. And so if conflict, if the source of conflict is being prideful and being self-centered, self-seeking, self-consuming, it only makes sense that we need to humble ourselves to get away from it. Seek refuge from the conflict that is within our lives. Because when we do that, when we have that position to, even though we are down low, God is lifting us up. Because we are saying no to the world yet, and yes to God. Because God comes back. Reach heaven. At that point is where we are as well. At that point, we are with Christ in heaven. So within those verses, there's nine commands that we need to do. Again, we're thinking of position change, hearing change, and thinking change. And then it ends with talking about how we are to relate to each other as brothers. It says, don't criticize one another. He who criticizes a brother or judges his brother criticizes the law and judges the law. But if you judge the law, you are not a doer of the law, but a judge. There is only one law to be judged, who is able to save and to destroy. But who are you to judge the law? Now, most people who believe and know, yet live in sin, have James 4:12 memorized. Because when anyone says anything is hell, you're not supposed to judge your brother. But here James is not saying that we don't call out sin, that we don't speak truth. What he's saying is that the right and the wrong way to do it. There's a criticizing way. The method about which we confront a brother and sister who's struggling with sin. We don't do it in a better way. We do it in love, with love and with grace. And we speak in truth. And a lot of times, Christians are given, are seen in a bad light because of, we're looked at as judgment people. We're looked at as those who judge and ridicule others because of the sin that someone else committed. Without looking at the law in our own minds, we would pull the splinter at someone who did. And that's what David is talking about here. Is we are not going to bear the love, we are not doing it the right way, and then you are criticizing them, not usually to their face, but behind their back. Brothers and sisters are accusing, ridiculing, and condemning someone else in the faith, and slandering their name, saying false things against them. That's when we judge. We are called to help and to bear one another's burdens as believers in God's church. Not criticize, because we are all sinners. We are all worthy of being judged by God. We are all worthy of the penalty of our sins as well. But God has forgiven. God has extended grace. And we need to do the same thing with our fellow brothers and sisters. So, to sum this up, we've got 10 words to summarize 1 through 12. I think it's going to make life easier. We can go down. It'll take us a lot of time. The food wasn't ready yet. So, we're just waiting over in there. So, but good words to remember James 4, 1 through 12. We need to first purify our reserve motives. We need to get close to God. Watch our prayer. Purifying our motives. Making sure that we're coming with humility, not with selfishness, not being self-centered, but not being self-seeking. We need to have that position change where we need to get close to God. Seek His guidance and counsel with His word. I'm close to Him in position. Let Him get in every part of our life. In dealing with one another, in the body of believers that is the universal church, we need to watch our faith. Previously in James in chapter 3, it talks about painting the cup. But James has already spent a lot of words talking about it. He hits it again at the end in verses 11 and 12. Destroy the relationship with their brothers and sisters and cause conflict and turmoil within God's church. They say, they win. It is full of practical application, full of many great commands, great words of wisdom. Hence why we are 2 months into James, and we've just finished up chapter 4 today. So, I want to encourage everyone to be reading James. There's so much that it's going to make us feel into the world. There's so much there to help us with our daily walk with Christ, and to align our wills up with God's will. I want to call you a third way of doing it. Realizing that it is us who causes conflict, not someone else. And that we change our position to get right with God in order to receive that peace that only comes to you. Let's go, God. Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you so much for just allowing us to hear your word this week. Help us to do these things. Help us to change our hearts to become less selfish. Less prideful, to humbly receive your grace and to bow before you in humility. Lord, help us to change our hearts. Help us to treat each other with love and respect. Help us to lift one another up and bear each other's burden. Help us all to live in spirit. Power of God's courage is that we can go through this together, that we don't have to do it all ourselves. We don't have to be selfish with even our Christian walk, where it's just on us to do these things. That's why we have each other. That's why God has asked us to be part of His church. And that's why we need to come to Him and repent of our sins. Confess Him as Lord, be buried with Him in baptism, be walking at Him. That is the invitation for everyone here. If you're not a Christian, today we are saved. What we can be saved and have that everlasting glory. Thank you for your time. If any need that the church may come to you,